to care, first of all, a reframing of what these conflicts are like and why actually civilians don't get services. Secondly, why civilians end up dying. Hint, it's not normally bullets, it's malnutrition. Thirdly, why poverty prolongs conflicts in two separate ways, number one relating to the ways that return alternatives of funds to the funding are received, and why these can productive for every group, so they're currently incentivized to do them. And then thirdly, oh sorry, within my third point of the sub-point, why poverty creates radicalization. Finally, some stuff about delegitimization about labeling radical groups as illegal and how currently states use this to prevent NGO cooperation and why we think that's bad. First of all, some rebuttal. Number one, we get told that states will take, rebel groups will take civilians hostage in order to extract concessions. Number one, we say, as Kat points out, that there are countervailing incentives from opportunistically grabbing civilians to take hostage, and indeed, as they point out, we suggest that there are groups will not do this. Secondly, we say that often these are not hostage situations. The point is, they are an example of things like blocked and controlled roads. Although we recommend a hostage situation might be plausible under some circumstances, what we suggest is that at that point we could plausibly say, no, we will not collaborate with this specific group who are employing this specific tactic, right? We do not have to endorse humanitarian groups operating in every single situation. They may be operating in the frame that I'm going to outline now, in which these is part of a wider problem. Moreover, we're willing to fight that bullet of them taking civilians hostage if it means that on a grander scale, we get more access to more civilians globally, and we are willing to say we get to take more lives. Fine, temporarily, we get less access to civilians. In the long term, however, more lives are saved, and we're willing, therefore, to make that, accept that thing. Secondly, we're told that this will make charities unpopular with civilian groups. We will do it secretly. Like we do charities are bombed out. We think that people die not because rebel
this funding, we're more likely to go for alternative sources of funding, which are potentially more disastrous. Given the relative potential gain, like from a diamond mine and a couple of hostage situations, why would they start there in the first place?
Okay, so this is literally the material I'm just about to get onto. So often doing things like controlling other roads, plantations, agricultural or mining is time consuming and is threatening wider freedom struggle or struggle to control territory by. You have a limited number of people and a limited number of resources. At that point you need to make trade-offs and decisions. When you need to get that source of funding, you have to make a trade-off, for example, by aligning with another group that you find unsavory, such as the Zapatistas who did not want to get initially involved in the drug trade, or you have to control a mine and redirect your concentration in a kind of more long-term sense. At the point at which you have a more direct source of funding, you no longer need to engage in these side activities for funding which distract you from your primary goal. These side activities are often incredibly harmful because they require things like slave labour. Secondly, they commonly create radicalisation because people flock to these groups when they are desperate and immiserated in order to get protection. At the point at which NGOs can access them, we think that these people are less likely to join rebel groups. Rebel groups, what they need the most is more people. We help those impoverished people, we stop them from joining rebel groups, we stop these conflicts going on, and even if we don't, we massively reduce their harm, and therefore they'll